All right. It is Wednesday, July 12th, and I am fortunate to be with Mr. Dennis Fisher, and we're going to talk today about aspects of the photographer. So Dennis, out of the ballpark question, when in country, what kind of music did you listen to in your free time?
Well, about the only thing you had a choice was to listen to was Armed Forces Radio. They had a popular music. They had different channels on there, but the only time you had a chance to hear any of it was when you were in the rear. Out in the field, just didn't have a way to listen to it. Now, a couple of the guys had these Zenith transoceanic radios that sometimes you could pick up stuff back from the States. But once again, that was only in the rear areas. I did my I had a girlfriend then down in Miami, and she gave my name to the local radio station, and they sent me an audio tape with a bunch of the popular music on that you could, that I could listen to at my leisure when I was in the rear and could find somebody with a tape player. So
Well, what was kind of popular when you were in country, 66 through 68? What you listening to?
Of course, the Beatles and the Mamas and the Papas, and that kind of stuff. A lot of the folk music. There was all kinds of stuff. I mean, just generally what was popular back then. It isn't like you had a choice of what you could listen to. It's whatever they happened to play. So, but I think the DJs were pretty much up on what guys were interested in hearing.
Now, speaking of music and entertainment, did any of the USO tours or anything, did you get to see any of those while you were in country?
Let's try to think. I saw one out at Hill 37, and it was a as I recall, I think it was an Australian group that was touring around. But no, I didn't get a chance to go to the USO shows very often. You had to just happen to be in the rear when they were performing in order to see them, and that didn't always work out. And sometimes I know when I was first in country, I think it was Anne Margaret was performing somewhere near us there in the rear. But I was just too damn tired. You're up all night on guard duty and stringing barbed wire and filling sandbags and doing stuff. And I'd just rather take the time and sleep. So,
I mean,
yeah.
absolutely. I can understand that, especially now in the field on operations. Would any of the companies you went out with, would any of those Marines carry those little portable radios with them in the field, or was that reserved for behind the wire?
I think that was more reserved for when you were back in the rear. I don't remember. The thing is, nobody wanted to carry anything they didn't absolutely need. You wanted to keep your pack as light as possible. And, typically till you have your rations and two or three canteens of water and, ammunition for your weapon, ammunition for other people's weapons, because we always carried like a mortar round for the mortar crew or 100-round assault pouch for the M60 machine gun. Those guys couldn't carry all the ammunition they needed, so everybody else would chip in and carry some for them. So, about the only thing extra people carried around was maybe material for writing, writing letters or a notebook for a small notebook for keeping a journal or something like that.
Well, and speaking of what you carried in the field,
Toothbrush, toothpaste.
how would you keep your
Yeah,
cameras?
we didn't carry.
Oh, go ahead, Dennis. I'm sorry, it cut
How
out.
did I what?
I was going to say, well, in the field,
No, you were saying about.
how would you keep your cameras clean, take care of them? Would you keep them in plastic? What would you do?
One camera I carried was an Iconus, which is an underwater camera, so it was pretty much impervious to everything. You just had to clean the front of the lens off, and it was pretty much good to go. But for the like the Nikon F, those, they came with a leather case that kind of protected them. But when helicopters landed and took off and stuff like that, you were just enveloped in dust and stuff all the time. Plus, during the monsoon season, trying to keep them dry. During the monsoon, I would generally keep my camera in a plastic bag. I think I had a plastic bag that the batteries came in for the radio, for the Brick 25 radios, and I'd stick my camera in there if it was actually, raining and stuff. But every day at the end of the day, when it started getting too dark to take pictures, but there's still a little afterglow light there, I'd usually get out my, lens cleaner and lens brush and stuff, and I'd clean the camera off and cl clean off the viewfinder, clean off the lenses, check and make sure there was no dirt inside the shutter mechanism area there, and just generally, keep them clean, get ready to go for the next day.
And with the film in itself, how many rolls of film would you typically have on operations with you?
I typically carry about 20 to 30 rolls, depending on, depending on how big. If I knew the operation was only going to be, a week long, I'd carry maybe 15 or 20 rolls. But if I knew it was going to be out longer, I'd carry more. And if it was just a couple of days or an overnight thing, or a daily thing, I'd just carry five or six rolls. Usually a mixture of Ektachrome X, which was a color transparency film, and Tri-X, which was a black and white film.
And with all these photographs that you took, you'd be in the field for a week, 2, 3 weeks at a time. When you went to develop them, could you use every photograph, or were some, what was the situation with the photographs?
No, generally, when I came back, I developed the rolls and make contact proof sheets of them. And usually my OIC or one of the gunnies or something, he'd look through them and make a selection of the ones he wanted me to print up or to, number and get prepared to send forward to headquarters, Marine Corps. Or the guys, the ISO guys, the combat correspondents that I was traveling with, they would come down to the photo lab, and they'd look through the contact proofs to find pictures that would go with the story they were writing while they were out with us. So it was, but generally out of every roll or so, they never picked more than like one picture. It was usually something exciting. Was never they weren't to now. Sometimes if we were covering like a med cap, a medical civic action program, these are kind of in the rear events, or co covering promotions or things like that. Those are the kind of pictures that they would release. The actual nitty-gritty combat stuff, or Marines that were wounded or anything like that, those never saw the light of day. They didn't publish those or send them out. So, at any rate, yeah, they'd pick a few pictures from every job, and that seemed to illustrate, what was going on, and that was that. I think the most I ever had picked was on Operation Cochise. They must have picked out about a dozen, and that was from a week and a half in the field. So,
Well, with the nitty-gritty pictures, what would headquarters do with those of the wounded and of the intense combat?
well, nothing. Nothing. That's why I still have a lot of these pictures, is those weren't ones that they selected. So, I mean, sometimes they would, if it was enemy dead or something like that, the intelligence people might want pictures to see uniforms or markings and things like that that might identify what outfit they were with. But I know. It was mainly just the feel-good kind of stuff that they published.
And would you be alerted if your photographs had made it into a Sea Tiger or in Leatherneck, or would you just find out by circumstance?
No, I just find out by circumstance. I know one time I hadn't been in, well, I'd been in the photo section there for probably 6 or 8 months, I guess, and one of my pictures was in the Leatherneck magazine, and just so happened one of our officers was reading Leatherneck magazine and saw it, and he told me about it. But no, I had no way of knowing. I mean, you take the pictures, the writers write the stories, And this stuff is all forwarded to the, to the headquarters Marine Corps, and they decide what to do with it, which may be nothing, you know. You got to remember, too, that as division photographers, we were competing, I mean, not trying to compete, but we were competing with the Stars and Stripes, who had their own photographers. The Air Wing had their own photographers. Third MAF had their own photographers. So there were a lot of other photographers out there in the field. I went through just about every picture that's in the National Archives, and I identified over 400 different photographers from the Marine Corps that had pictures in the National Archives there. Wow. So there were a lot of them out there. And now maybe some of them only went out once or twice, and they weren't really combat photographers, but still, you know, they were out there taking pictures. I mean, to the people back in the States, just being in Vietnam was being in combat, but being in Vietnam, only about 10% of the people actually participated out in the field in combat operations. Most were support personnel. So,
well, and going off of the combat operations, as a photographer, what would you try to shoot out in the field? What angles would you approach?
Well, first of all, you got to be where the action is. So, you know, they would have kickoff meetings before the operation actually started. And this was normally just reserved for the officers and senior NCOs to discuss, you know, the operation, what was going to go on and everything. But I would frequently sit in on those to find out what was going to happen on the op and find out what units were most likely to be in contact with the enemy. And so I would, you know, then request to get assigned to those units to travel with them. But once you're in the field, you just kind of go wherever you hear the shooting, you know, go to the sound of the guns, and you know, that's where the action is. So,
and from that point, with combat breaking out, as a photographer, it's got to be pretty hairy with bullets flying and you're there to capture photographs. So what do you try to take a photograph of? I guess the Marines and the firefights?
Yeah, for sure. There's riflemen, there's the mortarmen, there's the machine gunners, there's the actual commanders in the field and stuff. I mean, there's the corpsmen that are treating the wounded. There's the helicopters coming and going. I mean, there's a lot of things going on that are picture worthy. It's just trying to get there when they happen. That's the difficult part. You can't be everywhere at once. And that's why they normally, on bigger operations, they would assign two or three photographers to the operation, so that hopefully we'd have somebody in place where things were happening, no matter who made contact with the enemy.
And with your cameras out there and the various photographers taking a variety of angles, did you ever have any cameras get destroyed in the firefights or lost?
I had one that got run over by an Amtrak. You know, we had set in for the night, and nobody likes digging a hole every night to sleep in. And so there was an Amtrak that, or no, it was a tank. It was an M48 tank was left in our perimeter to kind of be there for, you know, security. And so I thought I'd just sleep under the tank and for protection, and which I did. And I got up in the morning and I had left my pack and my equipment and everything there while I went to look up the squad leader to find out what we were going to be doing for the day. In the meantime, the tank fired up and drove off and rolled right over my stuff. And the camera wasn't destroyed, but it did, the pressure of the treads pressing down on everything, it broke the seals on the lenses. You know, the lenses are like hermetically sealed. And so the consequence of that was every morning that the lenses would be fogged up. They would draw damp in there from the humidity, and you'd have to keep them out in the sun till, you know, for an hour or two till the moisture evaporated. But Del Vecchio, he was taking a picture and he took a bullet into his camera by actually one of our own people with a 45 shot, and the bullet went through his two of his fingers. He was holding the camera up, like in a vertical position, and the bullet went through these two fingers and then lodged in the film cassette of the camera. So he was real lucky. And yeah. So yeah. And you can see pictures when trying to think of my mind's just blank here. The Perkins, when Perkins was killed, he's the one of the Marine Corps combat photographer that got the Medal of Honor. He was a motion picture photographer, and his camera was pretty much blown up. I've seen pictures of it. It may be on display in the Marine Corps Museum, but I don't remember seeing it when I was there. So yeah, some of the cameras were damaged like that.
Well, and I'm glad you mentioned the museum. Have you talked with the museum about having any of your photographs on display there for the National Museum of the Marine Corps?
Yeah, I actually did. I had a the guy, I can't think of his name off the top of my head, but he was in charge of curating all the displays in the Marine Corps Museum. And he took me on, my wife, on a behind the scenes tour of the whole museum, including some exhibits there. They were doing one on Fallujah, which is not open to the public yet, but he took me back behind to see what they were doing on that. And I talked to him about the photographers being better represented in the museum. A lot of the pictures they had on display were ones taken by civilian photographers. And I said, our guys are our own Marines, took plenty of pictures and good ones. And I had suggested that, it was any one of their scenes, their diorama, big life-size dioramas that they have depicting action, any one of those, you could insert a photographer in there and it'd be perfectly appropriate because that's where we were, So anyway, there is some discussion going on about that. He's emailed me back and forth a couple of times. I haven't followed up recently because I've been busy with other stuff, but yeah, that's
Well,
one goal we're looking at. And he was aware of that. He said it's just finding the pictures that they could use that takes time.
it's like we've talked about this before, with your photographs, but I think about Del Vecchio, I think about your pictures, and there are more than ample enough to choose from. I think about Del Vecchio's photograph that was on the front cover of the Sea Tiger of the Marines advancing online into the bunker positions. Plenty of the ones that you took of the 27th Marines that would be excellent examples in the National Museum of the Marine Corps to show the photographer aspect to the public.
Oh, absolutely. But like anything, all these change comes slowly to the military, and the Marine Museum is no different. I mean,
Yes.
there's a lot to consider when you're putting one of these exhibits together, considering it's going to be there for a long time, and they want to make sure they get everything right. A lot of the dioramas, the people that they have in the dioramas were actually the faces were actually fashioned from the actual people that they're representing. So they're very lifelike. So.
And that's one of the things I love about the dioramas there. And speaking of photographs, this is one of my favorite photographs of you in Vietnam. And it's this classic one here, taken of yourself. And I've always loved the helmet graffiti. So what did it stand for, Dennis?
Tam, that was my girlfriend's name, Tammy.
And did you have anything else graffitied on your helmet?
Oh yeah. I have my helmet right here. Let's see here. A lot of the guys would put like a short timer calendar on it where they'd have all the months checked off as they were going. But I guess you really can't see here. It says photographer across the back. On the side here, it says napalm sticks to little children. Yeah, just a little. The names of operations. I see on here No Name 2, Allen Brook, Baxter Garden. Yeah, these things are all starting to fade off of the helmet cover with age. Let's see. I can't even read some of this stuff anymore. But yeah, Allen Brook, Kilo 3-5. Yeah, Baxter Garden, Hotel 2-5. So yeah.
Well, and
some
I think
guys
it's
were very creative with what they put on their helmets, and some weren't.
So. Well, I love that you kept the operations on there, and the unit that you were with on that operation, and that you've kept it after all these years. How did you get the helmet home?
Actually, it's just the helmet cover I brought home. The actual helmet I got here in the States. Yeah, I didn't bring the actual helmet home. And plus, helmets changed a couple times. You know, when I got wounded, of course, went to the hospital, you turn in all your gear. And then when you come back a couple months later, you're issued a new helmet and, you know, new everything. So, yeah, everything changed.
Well, and speaking of change, in this photograph, you've got the infamous grease gun that's situated
Yeah.
there.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, you were in a firefight once with that, and when you started shooting it, didn't both sides stop shooting for a moment?
Well, just for an instant, you know, it's this thing where, you know, if you've been in the field for a while, everybody knows the sound of the different weapons, you know. That's why they tell you if you capture an enemy weapon, don't start shooting it, you know, because the other Marines that are not close to you won't realize what's going on. They think it's the enemy firing, you know, because, you know, you could tell the sound of an AK or an RPD or a Dragunov sniper rifle or, you know, the mortars. The mortars were confusing because they had 60 millimeter mortars and we had 60 millimeter mortars. They both sounded the same. So, well, at any rate, so when I started firing that grease gun, that was an unfamiliar sound. And just for a fraction of a second, you know, everything went silent while everybody was trying to ponder, even the enemy, I think, what the hell is that, you know? but only for a second, you know, so.
Well, how was the grease gun for what you utilized it for in combat? Was it effective?
Well, yeah, it was. I, you know, I really fired it in combat one time, one operation there on No Name 2. And that's only because I thought we were being overrun. Yeah, after I got wounded, I took a lot more critical view of making sure I had adequate protection, shall we say, for myself, because I knew what could happen if you screwed up. So, yeah, when I had a chance to pick up this grease gun, I figured that was, you know, our regular weapon was a 45 automatic pistol. This shoots the same bullet. It just shoots a lot more of them faster. So
well,
the downside to the grease gun, it's a heavy weapon, and the magazines, I don't know if you've ever shot a 45 or you handled 45 ammunition, but it's pretty heavy too. When you have four magazines with 30 rounds in it, plus another mag in the weapon with another 30 rounds, you know, the weight starts adding up. I think probably the weapon with all the magazines probably weighed about 12 or 14 pounds. So,
well, and but looking
the nice part, the nice part about it was it hung low on your hip there, and it didn't encumber you when you were taking pictures.
Well, and looking at the photograph, where would you keep the magazines at? Because I see the flak jacket, I can see your pack. Where would you keep them?
Well, you can't see the pack I'm wearing and all the other stuff. It's actually, you know, the magazines are behind me. I have some, I may have some other pictures that from the back or from the side that show the magazine pouch. The magazine pouch wasn't a regular American issued one. It was one that I think was made by the Vietnamese, and it was really meant for 20 round magazines. So these magazines were too big, but they fit after a fashion. And it just hooked onto my cartridge belt, the same thing that you hooked your canteens onto and your jungle kit and other equipment. When I think of all the junk we carried, you know, I mean, it all adds up. And just the flak jacket itself, these older style flak jackets were pretty heavy too. Yeah, all that stuff added up. And boy, out in the summer sun, you know, it was something. I guess when you're young, you're able to endure that kind of stuff better.
Absolutely.
You can also see there that I have on stateside boots. I don't have jungle boots on there. And this photo was taken on Operation Rock, which was the first big operation I went on after I got back from the hospital. They had issued me new clothing and stuff, but they didn't have any jungle boots in stock in my size. So I just had to stick with my stateside boots.
Now, was that out of regulations for the time? Was anything said about the stateside boots?
Oh, no, no. You could wear whatever you wanted. Nobody cared. But if everybody wanted the jungle boots, but getting them was another question. First priority always went to the grunts, you know, the guys out in the field, of course, and the guys who worked in supply, who always managed to have the latest and the greatest, even though they never went out in the field. So, but at any rate, yeah, the grunts did and should have had priority for all that stuff.
Well, and speaking of the grunts, when you interacted with them on operations, what would you do to fit in that way that they knew that they could trust you?
Well, that's certainly a good question because, you know, like when I was wounded, you certainly wanted somebody to come drag you back out of the line of fire, you know. So you wanted to kind of be friends with these guys. Part of what made it easy for me to fit in is I was an infantry rifleman. That's what I was trained as. I went to Vietnam as an infantry rifleman, spent 6 months as a rifleman before I got into photo. So, you know, they have their own lingo, their own talk, their own, I know how they're going to maneuver and things they're going to do almost before they know it, because that's what I did, you know. So that was helpful in my photography in that I could pretty much anticipate what they were going to do next and be in a good position to get photographs. Yeah, actually, when I went out in this operation, I had requested to go out with the same squad I was with when I got wounded, because it was Lima 37, I believe. And so when I got out to the field, you know, I was expecting to reconnect with all the guys I was with the time when I got wounded, but there was only, I think, one or two guys left from that squad. Of course, the two machine gun guys that I was with when I got wounded, they got wounded even worse, and they were gone back to the States. And other guys had either rotated back to the States or been wounded themselves. But yeah, they called themselves the Dirty Dozen, and they were down to only about of those. They never had a dozen to start with. That was based on an old movie title that was popular at the time. There was a movie called The Dirty Dozen, and these guys like to take that moniker, but in reality, they never was a dozen of them. I don't know of any squads full strength. And normally a squad is made up of 3 4-man fire teams and a squad leader and a grenadier. And but most of the squads were never more than eight or nine guys at the most. So at any rate, but to fit in with them, you just, you know, shoot the shit with them during downtimes, you know, when we're stopped for breaks and find out a little bit about them. This was a good time to get information for captions and things like that, so that you can't really be asking them questions for your captions in the middle of a firefight. So it's good to have all this information before you actually get out in the action.
Absolutely. And with getting to know these guys, they have to respect you for it because you're out there in the shit with them. You're willing to share the burden with them. That's got to matter for a lot of things out there.
Yeah, and I mean, I would always volunteer to carry a mortar round or an assault pouch for the machine gun or whatever, because these guys are protecting me as well, you know. So, and they, I don't know how to explain it. It's just you just build a camaraderie out there, and of course, I always tried to when I got back to the rear. To print up pictures of some of these guys and send them out through the courier mail out to these units, and hopefully they would get a chance to see some of the pictures of themselves. And these would be ones that never made it into the Sea Tiger or something like that.
Well, and I know that you've reached out to me, and we've talked about that after the war, you've had Marines and families of Marines reach out to you about the photographs. How does that make you feel?
Well, it's interesting because I didn't put that much importance on these photographs. After all, these were culls, or you know, that's what we called them, culls, ones that weren't used, you know. And it wasn't until these people started asking about them and I started looking through them again, you know, 50 years later, that I realized, well, there's some really good photographs here. And so that's when I started trying to track down other members that I'd photographed and send them presentation prints so that they had something for their kids or their family to show what it was like when they were in combat.
Well, and with that as well, I mean, even just looking in the background, you've got a photograph of a wounded Marine that you've taken. So I assume your family, as well, is curious as to what you looked like when you were a young Marine in the 1960s, as well as the photographs that you've taken.
Yeah, I mean, if you see my picture then and now, they would need name tags, you know. You're at my age, you're just not recognizable as to what you looked like when you were 20. So,
Well, and speaking of the photographs, how many photographs do you think you took while you were in country?
oh, I don't know. I would say probably a few thousand, and all of them, I didn't get to keep the culls from all of them. When I went to the hospital, a lot of my stuff never made it. You know, when you go to the hospital, at least out of country, you know, if you're wounded in country and you're only going to be in the hospital for a few days or a week, nothing happens. All your stuff is still there in your hooch when you get back. But in my case, I got sent to Guam. They didn't know if I was ever coming back, if I would be sent home to the States, to a hospital in the States after that, or what. So they pack up, they inventory and pack up all your stuff, and they send it to, in this case, they send it to a storage facility in Okinawa. And it's kept there until they find out where you're going to end up, and then they forward everything to wherever you are. So in my case, when I got out of the hospital on Guam, then the Marines always went through Okinawa, either going or coming to Vietnam. And so I went through and I looked through my stuff. And one thing I noticed right away is all my personal cameras were missing. And I was really pissed because I thought the guys, somebody ripped them off back before they shipped all this stuff off to storage. And so when I got back in country, luckily, one of my friends there, one of the sergeants, had taken my cameras and kept them locked up, and he had them waiting for me when I got back. So,
Now, are those the cameras sitting behind you? Those are the ones right there, the personal ones?
no, my personal FTN from back then got stolen when I was going through Okinawa on my way home from Vietnam, and so no, the one I carried for the Marine Corps, and the one on my personal can. Now the Nikonis sitting back there is, let's see here. This is what I actually carried in Vietnam.
Wow.
And you know, these cameras, they were rugged and they were waterproof and they'd take a beating, but the problem is there's no there's no through the lens reflex focusing. You have to, there's a dial here on the front for the f-stop and the for the f-stop and the focus, and you have to guess, well, that's about 15 feet. You set it for 15 feet and you set the exposure, your F number, and up here's the shutter speed, and you'd set that up and, you know, hope you got a good shot, you know. And no light meter in this either, so you either had to use a handheld light meter or guess. And I when I say guess, it's not so much a real guess because, you know, we had our own kind of built-in eyeball light meter. But at any rate, I forgot what the question was now.
Going back to, for example, using that Nikonis, how long would it take you to set up just a single photograph, having to mess with the distance, the f-stop, and setting all that together?
Well, considering it was a, you know, it was a wide-angle lens, it was 35 millimeter wide-angle lens, you know, I didn't usually have it set for 10 feet or so, and if I'm walking around and it's, I'm using Ektachrome in it that had an ASA of 64, so a bright sun exposure would be a 60th of a second at f/16. You know, I knew all this stuff, and I would leave it preset to that. If some clouds came over and stuff, I can always open the f-stop up, one stop or stop and a half, whatever I felt it took. So it was already kind of preset. And you have pretty good depth of field on the wide angle lens, so you didn't have to be exact on the focus. But I mean, the picture up behind me, the one of the wounded Marine, that was taken with an Nikonis there. So
now, when you went to the National Archives, how many of your photographs were you able to find?
30 some of them. I forget the exact number. It was 34, 35, something like that. Plus, there were a couple that they know are in the archives that they couldn't find. So, and one of those was the photo of Fred Smith, the guy who's now the FedEx. Well, I think he's retired, but he was the founder of FedEx and the chairman of the board and everything. So that's one picture they couldn't find. They're still looking for it.
Now, with these photographs, I know that you've done a symposium. Are you going to do any more of those? Set up little museums to showcase it while you still can?
Yeah, if the opportunity presents itself, yeah. I've been trying to, one of the ladies from the National Archives recommended a program, which the name slips my mind right now, where you can, set up a, like a self-running presentation with narration and everything that you could put online or on the web. That I wouldn't need to be there, but it would still run all the slides that I wanted to show and stuff. So, yeah, there's a number of, I guess, different opportunities. I was contacted yesterday by the, I've had a couple contacts recently. One is from another historian who's interested in the work I did from the aspect of the Nikon cameras. He's a historian kind of for Nikon cameras. And then I had a contact from a military museum in Missouri, and they have a big exhibit on the 27th Marines. And they have one of my pictures there that one of the guys donated. And they wanted to know if I would be willing to support them with other photographs and stuff. So, sure.
Absolutely. And that's outstanding and amazing. I know with some of the photographs you've emailed me and that I found on the internet, I use those in my class, and students love it. I mean, they love looking at it. I know when Del Vecchio came, the kids were glued to the stories of a combat photographer because it's incredibly unique. I mean, you're looking at that's less than 1% of all Marines in country that are combat photographers or correspondents.
Yeah. You know, when I figure that, like I said, I found about 400 different unique names over the whole period of time Marines were in Vietnam. I don't know the total number of Marines that were there, but it was a small percentage. I mean, in our section alone, you know, the first division photographers, I don't think the numbers were always changing. Guys were coming and going and stuff, but I would say we never had more than 25 people there. And that includes, staff and administrative personnel that don't go to the field. It includes the camera repair guy who doesn't go to the field, maintenance people. So,
well, and I know in the movie, Full Metal Jacket, when they show the photographers all having a meeting about different USO tours or operations happening. Was that common where you'd be called together every so often for a meeting about it?
Well, as a, you remember that the Full Metal Jacket was more about the combat correspondence than it was about the photographers. Although Gus Hasford, the guy that wrote it, we lived in the same hooch, so I knew Gus well. We went on combat operations together. But he wrote it from a, from kind of a photographer's point of view, but he was really good friends with quite a few of the combat correspondents. And he wanted to, he had a bent or a desire or whatever to write about Vietnam. And so I was really surprised when he was the one that came out with a successful book, kind of more so than the actual correspondents that were over there. But Dale Dye has written a number of books too, not all on Vietnam, but he was a combat correspondent over there.
Well, and looking
but
at
any rate, as far as us getting together and talking about this stuff, usually it was mostly hearsay. Some guy would come in from the field and say, "I just heard this," or "I was just talking to somebody," or our officers who would, our officer who would go to the staff meetings and stuff and find out about upcoming operations and things that were happening, and he would come back and tell us. Most places had a bulletin board. You could never get everybody together at one time. There were always people in the field. There were people in the hospital. There were, they were just scattered all over. So getting everybody together at one time was almost an impossibility, just because of the nature and the way things were going over there. But that being said, they would post everything on the bulletin board, and it was your duty to read the bulletin board to see what was actually on there. And so we kept pretty much, and the USO tours, the word about those really spread fast, especially if it was some big name person that was coming around to perform.
Well, and speaking of some of the operations, did you ever work with any photographers from the 3rd Marine Division, or was it always within the 1st Marine Division?
No, I never did anything with the 3rd Marine Division guys. Although when I was in Fubai with Task Force X-Ray, Fubai is now like 60 miles north of Da Nang, and Da Nang is where my real base was. But when I was assigned to Task Force X-Ray, I moved up to Fubai and shared facilities with the ISO guys who also were part of Task Force X-Ray. And I used the 3rd Marine Division Photo Lab, which was at Fubai. Fubai was the rear area, like Da Nang was division headquarters for the 1st Marine Division. Fubai was division headquarters for the 3rd Marine Division. And so I used their facilities to process my film and stuff. And I knew some of the guys, but I didn't know them well. And I didn't go out on operations with them.
Now, within the realm of your operations that you've been on, which one stands out the most to you?
Well, for trying to think, there's a few, of course, No Name 2 stands out because of the intensity of the fighting and the number of Marines that were killed on that. And Operation Baxter Garden, which was just a week after No Name 2, and it was in the same area. It was kind of like No Name 2 kind of prodded the beast, and they decided to go in with a massive force of Marines with Baxter Garden to clean this place out. But they never really, they didn't really clean it out. There had been, before the No Name operations, now this is an area that's just a mile or so east of the city of Hue, And Hue is almost on the coast. So it's a very short distance, just a few, I think maybe 2 or 3 miles from the city to the coast. And in that strip of land between the ocean and between Hue was a big rice growing area. And the North Vietnamese, when they got driven out of Hue during the Tet Offensive, moved into that area. And they dug in, fortified the place. I mean, they were ready for a fight. And so we had this Operation Ford, which went in there to clean them out. Well, that didn't work. Then they had these no-name operations. They had no-name one and two, and those really didn't solve anything. And then they decided to go in big time again with Operation Baxter Garden. That pretty much put the kibosh on them, but it did never ended the problem totally. So anyway, those two operations, and Alan Brooke was a big operation that was part of the what we call Mini Tet or Tet II. This was in the summer of 1968, south of Da Nang on a piece of land called Go Noi Island. And Go Noi Island was like a staging area for the North Vietnamese in preparation for an attack on Da Nang. And the Marines went in to clear this place out. And it was in physical size. If you see it on a map, it's maybe a couple miles wide and about 8 or 9 miles long. And it's only really an island during the rainy season. The river runs along one side of it, but when the water's high, it kind of there's another channel that surround, goes around the other side of the land and turns it into an island. And when we were there in the summer, of course, it was during the dry season and wasn't really an island, but it's still known as Go Noi Island. And the fighting went on. It was supposed to be, I think, a couple week operation. Went on for almost 3 months, and they were just fighting all over the place. The 27th Marines that I had photographed up on No Name 2 were part of that battle, and several of the guys that I photographed were killed on Alan Brooke. The guy up on top of the pagoda, firing the M60 machine gun, Jeffrey Rosen, he was killed there. His assistant gunner was killed there. They had a lot of heavy fighting down there.
Well, and I've got this copy of Sea Tiger that mentions Operations Alan Brooke, and this is a photograph taken by Del Vecchio of a 2-7. And with Alan Brooke, considering the size and the vastness, and it utilized combined arms. I mean, tanks were on this operation, and you were correct. I mean, it was dug in. They were waiting for a fight. I mean, bunker complexes were found galore. Now, would you photograph the bunker complexes for division to study the layout of the bunkers?
I was never there when they found any of the big bunker complexes, and usually there wasn't a lot of investigation done. They would either blow them in place. Toward the latter parts of Alan Brooke, they brought in the Seabees with a whole bunch of bulldozers, and they just started leveling the island. They just had given up on trying to find all these hidden locations, and they just started burying everything. But
And
no, but most of the big bunker complexes that I heard about were up in the mountain areas, down in the Quezon Valley and Hep Duc and places like that.
now, with your job as a photographer, were there certain things that were supposed to be off limits?
No, not really. There was nothing that was all. You could shoot anything you wanted, but whether anything got done with those pictures or not was another question, Now, we tried to, I kind of self-censored my stuff. I tried to not show the faces of dead Marines. And because you never know that somehow these pictures could escape and they would be seen by the relatives before they were officially notified that this person was killed. But other than that, I didn't see any need to really show the faces of our dead. And the other thing you had to watch for, I mean, these guys are out on these operations in summer heat wearing the same clothes for weeks at a time, and they literally start to rot off your body. The armpits would rot out of your jungle jackets, the crotch would rot out of your pants and stuff. And since nobody wore any underwear, you had to be careful when you were taking pictures that nothing was exposed, shall we say. So other than watching for that, but you know, I never really was censored on what I could shoot.
Well, and you bring up an interesting point of being in the field, the exposure of people's clothes rotting off. What's that smell like when you finally smell yourself after being in the field for weeks at a time?
Well, I don't know. I kind of felt, I think you just got used to it and it didn't seem abnormal, you know, until you came in and got a nice shower and got cleaned up. And then some other guys came in from the field. Then you noticed it. Yeah.
And being in the field, oftentimes, how would you go to the bathroom? Things like that, of that nature, simple things.
Well, you'd either dig a hole to go to the bathroom, or you know, to defecate, you know. But usually, we would just use abandoned enemy trenches and stuff, and use those for the toilet if there were any around, you know. But now, yeah, I mean, you did what you had to do. I mean, a lot of times you'd go for a week at a time with never going to the bathroom, except for you know, urinating. So.
Well, with that, and did you ever have any food shortages of sea rations running low or water running low?
No, we always carried enough that if the supply was interrupted, we had enough to last us until, and you didn't eat much. I mean, you know, when I went over there, I weighed 185 pounds. When I went into the hospital 10 months later, I weighed 165 pounds, you know, so the weight just melted off you.
Well,
because you didn't eat much.
And with the humping you guys are doing, you know, throughout the day, on a normal day, in on a patrol, on an operation, how far could you move in a single day with a company or a platoon?
It depends on whether, you know, like that Operation No Name 2, we were fighting, and on Baxter Garden 2, we were in an area where there was a lot of booby traps and stuff, and you just couldn't move very fast. You know, you had to make sure everything was clear before you started moving forward. If you're out in the mountains and stuff, like down in Quezon or over in Dialock, over in those areas, Ashaw Valley and stuff, I mean, if you did, I'd say 5 to 10 kilometers a day, you were doing good. I mean, there was no hurry. I mean, you know, you had objectives for the day. The objective could be a couple kilometers away, or it could be 5 miles away. So whatever the objective was for the day, that's how far you marched.
Now, when you would be on these operations marching, would you be near the platoon leaders, or would you try to fit in with, as you said earlier, the rifle squads that are typically up near the point, somewhere along that line, the enlisted?
Yeah, I tried to stay with the rifle squads. I'd pick one squad and just stay with them unless the action was taking place somewhere else, and then I would move to that company or that squad. Yeah, so I tried to stay, and that's because you get to know the guys better, and you start getting more information about them for captions and so forth, as I mentioned earlier. And
and I guess with your job, in some ways, you showing up in the field is a morale booster for some Marines, knowing that maybe their photograph's going to appear in a newspaper or something like that.
I don't know if it was a morale booster, but it made them, it kept them motivated, you know, to look good in front of the camera. So, yeah.
It's unique to analyze that. Now, what are your thoughts?
Now, and about, you talked about traveling with the, you know, with the command group, you know, which would be the company commander or whatever. You know, I'd usually check in with him a couple of times a day if nothing was really going on, just to see what was happening. But you got to remember that each one of these squads had a radio man, and you could hear the radio traffic as you're walking along and hear what's going on with other squads. And you could hear the company commander talking to them and telling them what to do or what's going on. So The main reason for talking to the company commander was to find out what was going on. But if you could get that information over the radio traffic, it wasn't necessary.
Well, and as a combat veteran photographer, what are your thoughts now on the Marine Corps not having combat photographers? Do you believe that they're necessary to tell the history of the Marine Corps?
Yeah, I think it was a mistake. The Navy did away with them altogether. The Air Force combined them into the communications squadrons. I'm not sure now how the Marines are going to handle documenting their combat operations. But yeah, I think it's like everything; it goes in cycles. You know, things will start happening, and then the command staff or the National Command Authority, you know, in the Pentagon, the White House, and stuff. They start asking for pictures, you know, what's going on out there? Because the pictures are what really tell the story. And all of a sudden, there'll be photographers start to be assigned again. So,
Absolutely. I mean,
yeah.
it's pivotal. I mean, I think about the sea tigers I have and the books I've read, and your name pops up several times. And I mean, it's history. It tells a story that otherwise might not be told.
Yeah.
And then two last questions for today. Number one, have you considered writing a book about your experiences as a photographer?
Yeah, I have. I've completed, I don't know, 20 some chapters. It's just a sequential recounting of my time in the Marines, starting with with enlistment and then boot camp, advanced infantry training, and then to Vietnam, and then getting assigned a photo, and then the various combat operations and stuff. I kind of followed it through that way. And I still have, for resource material, I still have copies of all my original orders, so I know when and where I was for different things. I have, of course, the captions and photographs that tell a lot about, their memory joggers for what was going on in various things. I have all the letters that I sent home to my parents. They kept all those, and so I have those to draw on. I can read those and see what I was telling them when and where. Things I was doing. And so, yeah, I have a lot of resources for to get it right, as far as the technical part of it goes. But yeah, I'm working on
That's phenomenal. Hopefully, I hope to see it published and in bookstores someday,
it.
and especially in my classroom, so I can tell my students and show the interviews that we've done. And lastly, for today, what's your favorite or most funny memory from when you were in Vietnam?
Well, one that really sticks out in my mind is when I was in a security platoon just before I got assigned a photo. It was they'd had a lot of trouble with guys in this security platoon getting in trouble for one reason or another, like having women on post at night. Prostitutes were sneaking into the bunkers and they had a couple guys in the brig and stuff. So the lieutenant really was looking for two guys he could count on to guard the general's house this particular night. And so myself and another guy, we were selected for that detail. And we went up there, and it's nothing happens. The general in the first division there, he had his own house up on the hill overlooking the division headquarters there. And so we're up there, and there's nothing to do except walk your post and keep an eye out for things. And it was just starting to get dark, and his helicopter landed. I thought, oh, we didn't even know if he was home or not. Just like he comes out to shoot the shit with the guys that are guarding his house. And the helicopter lands, and out jumps a girl, round eye. And I thought, whoa, who could this be? And as she gets closer, I recognize it was Jane Mansfield. And she had been there for a USO tour, and she was staying at the general's house. And so just the way the layout was, they had to walk right past us. I mean, the walkway is only a couple feet wide. And she stopped and she gave us both a kiss on the cheek, and she thanked us for what we were doing and everything. And I thanked her for taking the time to come over and entertain the guys and everything. And she said, well, she was only going to be in country a few more days, and then she had to head home. And what I would find out in the next month or so in the news is that she was killed in a car accident shortly after that. So, yeah. So that was one thing I remember.
Definitely
more a funny thing than a serious thing.
Definitely a lasting impact of her taking the time to do that. I mean, it definitely means something to a grunt like you that's doing his job.
Yeah. Yeah,
and
for sure.
You mentioned something that brought up one more question I had. What was some of the lingo, if you don't mind getting into it, that you used in the field as a rifleman and as a photographer? What did grunts talk like?
Well, you know, I'd have to think about that. You know, there's a lot of terms and things that we used. You know, there were nicknames for almost everything. You know, an M79 was a blooper. You know, an M60 machine gun, that was the pig. And I mean, you had all these little acronyms for things that, to the untrained, and it's the way that most of us veterans can separate wannabes or stolen valor kind of guys, because they never learned that language. And it's something only we understand. I can get you a kind of a little list. I'd have to sit down and think about it a little bit. But it isn't until I start talking with another vet and these things just come flowing out, you don't even think about them, you know. But absolutely. Yeah, I'd have to think about that a little bit.
Well, I'd love a list, that's for certain. As always, Dennis, thank you for your service. Thanks for taking the time to do this, and welcome home.
Okay. Well, thank you, Zach. We'll be talking to you soon.